Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Islam. We would like to thank our viewers for the many letters and phone calls we have received regarding our current series of programs, The World of the Quran. We urge you to please continue to send us your important comments and questions. And we would like to add that should you need a copy of the Quran, we would like to send you one. Please call us at the number that you will see on the screen throughout the program, and we will be more than happy to get it in the mail to you. In today's program, we shall see what the Quran has to say about the issue of law as an instrument of morality. The Quran propounded an ethical teaching and a law, and the Prophet, acting under divine inspiration, exemplified both, giving them a concrete aspect. And so, the complete Sharia of Islam was ushered into existence with the words, "Today I have perfected your religious law for you."
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Merciful.
وأنزلنا إليك الكتاب بالحق مصدقا لما بين يديه من الكتاب ومهيمنا عليه فاحكم بينهم بما أنزل الله. فاحكم بينهم بما أنزل الله ولا تتبع أهواءهم عما جاءك من الحق لكل جعلنا منكم شرعة ومنهاجا ولو شاء الله لجعلكم أمة واحدة ولكن ليبلوكم فيما آتاكم فاستبقوا الخيرات إلى الله مرجعكم جميعا فينبئكم بما كنتم فيه تختلفون.
And unto thee have we revealed the scripture with the truth, confirming whatever scripture was before it, and a watcher over it. So judge between them by that which Allah hath revealed, and follow not their desires away from the truth which hath come unto thee. For each we have appointed a divine law and a traced out way. Had Allah willed, He could have made you one community. But that he may try you by that which he hath given you, he hath made you as ye are. So vie one with another in good works. Unto Allah ye will all return, and he will then inform you of that wherein ye differ.
The Quran calls itself Guidance for Mankind, Hudan lil Nas. Its central moral concept is taqwa. Though taqwa can be translated as piety or God consciousness, its full impact could only be felt by understanding it as the sense of responsibility from which all activities must proceed, and recognizing clearly that judgment of these activities is ultimately with God. Therefore, the ethics, morals, and principles enunciated all throughout the Quran and the life of the Prophet, which are the main sources of Sharia or Islamic law, are based on upholding the moral principle of taqwa. Thus, in the Quranic view, law and morality are inseparable. One can understand this better if one sees the chaos in our societies resulting from the gradual erosion of an inner sense of responsibility, which is undoubtedly linked to a process in which law has ceased to maintain any organic relationship with morality.
The Quran wants to establish on earth a society, a social order, on a viable ethical basis. But in order to do that, it is very clear that this cannot be brought about without what it calls taqwa. I've mentioned the word taqwa earlier.
Right.
But the word taqwa in most contexts in the Quran, although its root meaning is, of course, to save from wastage and destruction, it is to avoid peril. Taqwa means to avoid peril. And what the Quran is saying is, do not do those things, do not put yourself into situations which will imperil you morally, which will destroy you morally.
Okay, we're talking both in the individual and the collective
sense,
right?
And the collective.
Right?
I will explain it a little further. In Surah 59, the Surah Al-Hashr, the Quran says, لَا تَكُونُوا كَالَّذِينَ نَسُوا اللَّهَ. Do not be like those people who forgot God. فَأَنْسَاهُمْ أَنْفُسَهُمْ. And eventually God caused them to forget themselves. And they were finished off. They disintegrated. So, in fact, God's function for the Quran is to integrate the individual and the collective personality. That is why God is so indispensable. Again, there is a well-known verse in the Quran which says, wherever there are three people, God is the fourth there. Wherever there are five, God is the sixth there. Wherever there are less or more, God is there. You see, God is an extra dimension which makes this integrality possible. Whenever there is more than one person, there is God there. And God is there because it is His presence that through regulating life among individuals, if there is more than one individual, I of course don't know if there are only one individual in the world, what would happen. But whenever there is more than one individual, a social situation is created.
The word Sharia means the path or the road leading to the water. That is to say, a way to the very source of life. Fundamentally, it refers to the way ordained by God, wherein man is to conduct his spiritual, mental, and physical life in order to realize the divine will. Thus, it comprehends both the faith and practice. Belief in one God is part of the Sharia, just as the religious duties of prayer and fasting. Further, all legal and social transactions, as well as all personal behaviors, are subsumed under the Sharia as the comprehensive principle of the total way of life. But the problem is, how is the Sharia to be known?
ثم جعلناك على شريعة من الأمر فاتبعها ولا تتبع أهواء الذين لا يعلمون.
And now have we set thee, O Muhammad, on a clear road of our commandment. So follow it, and follow not the whims of those who know not.
The experience of many Muslims who are committed Muslims, and a question that often some outsiders will also raise, but certainly the experience of many Muslims, is that they look at their governments in the implementation of Islam and say, who's Islam? Is it simply to be, if we're going to have an Islamic state or an Islamic society, is it simply to be imposed by kings, by military rulers, or even by ulama? Or do the people have an input? You know, what is the rule of shura here, you see? And then what Islam? Is it to be simply selective implementation of Islam? Is it to be a negative Islam, that is, only the hudud and therefore regarded as negative because the fullness of the law isn't applied? Is it to be Islamic law as it was delineated and developed in the early centuries of Islam? Or is it to be Islamic law as now re-examined and reinterpreted? I think that's a real tension within the community. Does the implementation simply of Sharia mean the implementation only of the fiqh, the understanding of the past, or does it include the fiqh to be developed, the understanding today? And I think that's a tension within the Muslim community.
Many of the verses of the Quran are concerned with the question of law, but not all of the injunctions in the Sharia are explicitly stated in it. About 80 verses are directly connected with specific aspects of law. For example, regulations about marriage, divorce, and inheritance are clearly formulated, While many other questions are only implicitly stated, there are many universal statements which need further explanation before they could become specific guides for human action.
The primary source, of course, is the holy book, the Quran, Al-Quran Al-Karim, which is the very word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which has the beliefs which a mu'min should have, a Muslim should have, believe in Allah, in the existence of angels, in the hereafter, in the books of Allah and the prophets of Allah. So detailed aspects of all these beliefs, but also it has some specific laws. The most detailed of those laws is the law of inheritance. Quran specifically provides as to who should inherit how much in case of death, and what if a particular person is leaving so and so, like a father or a mother or a brother, and if what if there are two brothers and two sisters. So it goes really into much more details. But of course there are other aspects, how to pray. In Quran, for example, doesn't say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't say how many rak'at you pray. But so as a supplement to the Quran, the second source of Sharia is Sunnah or Hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is a compilation of the sayings of the Prophet as well as his deeds. People saw him doing things in a certain way and considered that as the way acceptable by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third source of Sharia is the consensus of the opinion of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that there were issues that they did not find in the Quran or in the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There was no specific guidance, nas, a special text on that particular issue. However, considering the overall spirit of the Quran and the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they reached to a conclusion and everyone agreed. So there was a consensus, and that is a third source of Sharia. Another source of Sharia is ijtihad, one's struggle. You face a situation, a new situation, and then you look into the sources of Sharia, which are primary sources of Quran and Sunnah and the Ijma, and then you reach to your own conclusion as to what would be the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or what would the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had been, had he been alive today, would have decreed in a given situation. So this is a process that is always evolving, and unfortunately at the last, in our recent history, this process of ijtihad has become stagnant. And there is a great need at this time, if you are to live Islamic life, that we revive this process and we educate people to be learned in applying the process of ijtihad.
The practice of ijtihad, or interpreting the law on the basis of informed opinion, is absolutely essential in order for the legal system to work. It does not mean to change the law to suit the convenience of men, but to face and solve every new situation and problem in conformity with the Sharia.
When we talk about evolution in the fiqh or in the Sharia, we do not mean that just because one has changed his residence or we are living in a different time than it was before, that we change the rules of Sharia to facilitate our life or to suit our purposes or whims. We have to remain within the framework of the Quran and Sunnah. But the example will be Salat or the prayer, for example. Or the Fuqaha have been talk about journeys in terms of how many days. Now if we apply the same rule, 2 days journey or 3 days journey, in today's aeroplane or conquered age, that we will miss the point. Or for example, fasting. What if you take a flight from here to Tokyo, going through the West Coast? you will be just following the sun. What do you do in this situation? Those are the type of things that never came up. Or, for example, in case of medicine, heart operations or blood taking from one body to another body, can you take from a non-Muslim's body to a Muslim's body, different kind of medical operations. So this is where I'm talking about, it, that where you didn't have a particular ruling, and now here is a situation and you have to decide according to Quran and Sunnah, and that's where the evolution and continuity of ijtihad is needed.
In understanding the Quran's social reforms, we will go fundamentally wrong unless we distinguish between legal enactments and moral guidances. This is where the Muslim legal tradition, which essentially regarded the Quran as a law book and not as the religious source of the law, went so palpably wrong. Only by so distinguishing can one not only understand the true orientation of the Quranic teaching, but also solve contemporary problems. The question then becomes, what in the true sense of the term is Islamic government based on Sharia?
Islam is the religion that brought the concept of consensus into any decision making, whereas at that time, feudal Europe did not believe in consensus. It believed in authoritarian feudal rule. Islam was already talking about consensus, and even the choice of leader is democratic. So when you are being chosen through a democratic system, however limited it may be, you have to be accountable. Otherwise, you will not be chosen. And the people who choose must learn that they have a responsibility to choose the right person, the right leader. So I think that Islam provides sufficient checks and balance if you practice it. But quite often, Islam accepts a very authoritarian form of government, and that authoritarian form of government then interprets Islam in order to perpetuate the system.
While the media in the West remains fascinated with expressions of retaliatory ethics and showcases these to be the entire sum and substance of Islamic law or Sharia, the piecemeal application of the sacred law by some Islamic governments do just as much disservice to the spirit of that law.
Western life and the world as we know it is all about communication. It's all about projecting an idea. And irrespective of what its content is, the packaging is all important. And somehow we failed because we haven't been able to speak to the West in the language the West understands. We're still subjugated by a literal-minded approach to our culture. And there's nothing literal-minded about Islam, or doesn't have to be. The Prophet Muhammad was an extremely iconoclastic person. He was someone who was challenging all accepted notions of his times. And Islam can continue to be that kind of challenging force and challenging social force. And so to become bogged down by literal-mindedness, to become so apprehensive of moving away from the most traditional view of our scriptures and traditions is, I think, to do ourselves a great disservice.
For centuries now, we have accepted the system of feudal rule, and we have become so accustomed to it, we have accepted the system so much that we feel that it would be wrong to go against it. And the system itself uses Islamic arguments to sustain itself, that you don't go against your ruler because that is wrong. And what you don't emphasize is that if the ruler is wrong, you have to go against him. So because of this ingrained attitude and belief, it is very difficult to reform the system. But over the years, I'm quite sure, as knowledge spreads, there will be a move. not to result in this system being taken over by people who will reimpose the system in another form. For example, you may find that some extremist group might take advantage of a democratic system in order to capture the government and then impose their own version of autocratic rule. That may well happen, of course, if you move towards a democratic form of government. But the people themselves must understand Islam sufficiently to know that that is not what Islam wants us. This vicious extremist group which stops at nothing in order to gain in power in the name of Islam, they say, these people are not truly working in the interest of Islam or in accordance with the teachings of Islam.
It is clear that the Quran does include some legislative edicts. Out of a total of 6,342 verses, less than 500 are prescriptive, the rest being an exhortation to piety and virtue in general terms. It is not by accident that the Quranic revelation is not prescriptive in the main. This is because the divine plan relegated lawmaking to humankind, as long as the principles and values of those laws embodied that which God had revealed. Assalamu alaikum, and thank you for joining us this week on Islam. We urge you to join us next week as we continue in our series, The World of Quran.